Greetings, minions. I am your humble narrator, Sideways Thinker. And I really should have got my timer on before I started recording. Don't know why I keep forgetting that. But yes, I'm just here with some more Let's Play this here Divinity Dragon Commander on that there PC. And sorry if the last episode was a bit loud and a little bit... and had a bit of a microphone knocking. I am aware of that. I did check the footage. I'm still trying to get used to this new mic. So there's going to be a few problems like that for a while. And is that Grumio? Are these like all just... are all these imps in the background just like Grumio's model? I think they are... yeah, they are clearly all... they're quite obviously all Grumio's model. Excellent. Right, let's see what we can research new. Not sure if there's actually yes, there is transport. I was gonna say, I don't think there's anything we specifically needed, but it's like, no, we do need transports if we are to, because here's the thing, they're not impressive, they're not that useful in combat, but they're very important for the map screen. Right, let's have a look at these new generals, Lord shall we? Dragon,
allow me to present your team of generals.
You've got a bit more polite.
Edmund, you already know. But I now have the pleasure of introducing you to Her Highness Lady Catherine, Queen of Westbridge, and Scarlet, not noble of birth, but the more so of heart.
So we've got, you know what, I was going to say Catherine, Queen of Scots, and then it occurred to me, no, it's Mary, Queen of Scots, isn't it?
We four have pledged we will stand by you in your conquest as a rightful heir to Revlon's throne. Bastard no longer... you shall be known as Commander until the day comes that you shall be King.
Yeah, you started respecting me pretty fucking quickly, didn't you, you bald bastard?
All hail the dragon.
Yes, all hail me. All bow down, slave.
Hail.
Oh god, hello.
Hail.
Oh god, hello.
Yes, well, hail.
Love you. Love you, Edmund. Good man. Oh, at least you joined in. You were fussy about it, but you joined in. It's good. Let's talk to you. I want to talk to you.
It's going to take some getting used to, you know, to call you Commander. Verily, I was rather opposed to the notion. But Maxos, in his infinite wisdom, insisted we up the level of common courtesy toward you. Commoner would have done. Commander, though, it shall be.
What do you mean, commoner? I mean, yes, I'm a bastard, but I'm a bastard son of a king, you prick. I'm still a noble, more noble than you. You do like to talk down to people, don't you? Oh god, don't have a fit, man. You do... stop having fits. How the hell... I'm trusting you with my army. Stop having fits. You like to talk down to people, don't you?
As much as it is in the eagle's nature to look down upon the world in hunt of lesser creatures, it is my genius that makes me soar high above all others. Lesser creatures, indeed.
You do realize I literally fly? Right, I'm a dragon with a jetpack. You do... and I am the king! You... king or emperor, whichever one you prefer, but... whatever.
At the lone top do I reside, but I would have it no other way. Those who do not understand, all but everyone, calls me a loner, thinking the word to be a pejorative. But it is on the contrary glorious to live in sweet isolation when all around you non-lizards, that is to say, inferiors, skitter and crawl like vermin.
Racism!
I am a solitudinarian, for my nature makes me so. And when I do have contact with those I loathe, inevitably I talk down to them as it is impossible to communicate on a level of equality when there is none to be had.
Oh god, really? Solitudinarian? I'm starting to think that everyone in this game must come up with these conversations before they happen, like sitting alone in their rooms. Right, Henry! Let's have a chat with you, Henry.
Yes, Commander.
Bastard no longer, am I? You uppity shit. By the way, yes, this is literally the best impression I can do of this character.
Seemed hardly proper to call you by that particular pet name on what was somewhat of an official occasion. But don't worry. I may still slip up once or twice, even though my respect for you is in fact growing. You've got a knack for bloody brutal battle. And feigned hard never won fair victory.
Good man. Take my leave. Okay. Which one of the new ones seems more agreeable? Well, she looks like she's posing for like... she looks like she's posing. She look... okay. Catherine looks like she's posing for one of those classic Victorian portraits, you know? One of those classic images of the person standing next to a bookcase, no, standing in front of a bookcase, perhaps, with a skull on a plinth next to them. Something like that. Scarlet looks like she's posing for Pinup Mag. So we've got a pinup photograph. It's Dr. Scarlet.
How's it hanging, Commander?
Oh, God.
I'm Scarlet, and you're a dragon, they tell me. Always wanted to ride one of those, though. I bet you're a little harder to handle than a horse. All part of the fun, though, I reckon. So give me a shout when I can take you for a spin.
Don't think I'm gonna... Sorry, there's a fucking weird white beetle that keeps driving forward and back in front of my house. I've got no idea what that is. Anyway, sorry, just completely distracted. But yeah, you know what? Believe it or not, I don't think I want you riding me, love. That's a bit... It's a bit forward, isn't it? I'm the king! You bloody... What's that one line from Game of Thrones? Any man who feels the need to shout, I am the king, is no true king.
Treat me mean, I'll scratch your eyes out. Treat me well, and I'll purr like a kitten. Your choice, Commander.
Yeah, I'm gonna back away. Yeah, gonna talk to this one.
I would say it is a pleasure to make your acquaintance, Commander. But as it stands, I must approach you with a bit of reserve. True, to know we have a dragon knight for a leader is a great relief. For such a grand creature inspires bravado in the many hearts that will have to be won so that we may overthrow the spreading dark.
Yeah, I distinctly remember what this character is something of a broad parody of.
But then again, you are the offspring, the male offspring to boot, of a sorry line prone to decadence and corruption. The very line, in fact, that is responsible for the downfall of the Empire in the first place. Forgive me, then, if I do wonder. Will this commander pass muster? Earn his wings? Earn his crown?
Yeah, the fact that she just went, the male offspring. You're probably picking up on the fact that this character is supposed to be a broad parody of feminists? Of extreme feminists. Let's hear a bit more of her opinion, shall we?
Because they call us females the fairer sex. But in truth, we are also...
Oh God, it started raining.
...resilient, refined, and downright intelligent.
I don't know if that's gonna...
Give an empire a queen, I say, and it will be ruled. Give it a king, and it will become an afterthought. For like any man, he is content when both his belly and his bed are filled with a prize piece of tender flesh. No more.
Sorry, again, I don't know how sensitive my mic is, so now I'm... This probably isn't the most interesting video. I've just spent half this video going like, oh God, is my mic gonna pick that up? Is my mic gonna pick that up? Oh God, I've got no idea. Sorry if you can hear the rain.
And should therefore be in charge of simple things only.
Yeah, so you may be able to figure this out. I am not a fan of Catherine. I mean, she may... Later on in the game, if it follows the path that I recall it following, she makes several... statements and brings several policy choices in the game that I agree with. I just hate her character because she's really irritating and sexist, frankly. She's powerfully sexist against men. But then again, she is a walking parody of... she's a living parody of... whatchamacallit. Yes, good job, Ethan. Whatchamacallit. But no, she... Great. She's a walking parody of extreme feminism, so... You kind of expect that. If we can zoom on over here so we can take this over. And let us trumpet these fuckers up here. And do they have any transports? Ah, they have that transport. So what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to actually put one hunter there. Let's wait a turn before I do anything else. Try and take over as much land as we can. Before we have to deal with these chaps. Famed generals flock to the banner of the bastard. Oh, we got a new card. Yeah, I've never fully understood how you actually acquire cards in this game. It does literally just appear to be sometimes you get one when Maxos throws you a card. Somewhat of an issue.
Ah, Commander, no doubt you've had an eventful and successful day so far. But don't rest on your laurels just yet. For I'm here to inform you the counselors have arrived.
Brilliant.
The ambassadors of the races whom you'll have to duel and deal with in the political arena. Such is both the prerogative and the burden of an emperor to be.
Excellent. Great. I love these people.
You may think your first duty is that of conquest, to bring the war to as swift an end as possible. But I'm afraid there is much more to being a monarch than military matters alone. As a commander, as an emperor, you'll have to constantly endeavor to find that delicate balance between your roles as strategist and statesman, for the one necessarily influences the other.
Sorry, I'm having a small heart attack about the fact that it's raining. Again, I'm sorry if you can hear that.
Now,
my room isn't exactly soundproof.
Some will worry about the price of bread, and others will gripe about taxes. When all around us, machines of war threaten the existence of the very realm. But if you give it a moment's further thought, this is only logical. We may find ourselves trapped amid a conflict of gargantuan proportions. But that does not mean the average man worries most about feeding his family. About the little things that make for a happy life. And when you have been given an empire, Commander, you have to be responsible for every matter, every obstacle, every creature, great and small.
Well, if you actually give a shit about ruling your empire, yeah.
This may seem daunting, but I have never and never will doubt for even an instant that you, of all people, will rise to the occasion. Your counselors await you in the throne room, Commander. Godspeed.
Right. Let's go meet the counselors. Oh, I love these people, and we'll discuss what they're all broad parodies of as well. To the throne room!
Ah,
there he is.
Everyone, shush! Here comes the long-awaited commander. The dragon that would deliver us from vile usurpers. The one deserving heir to Rivalon's throne.
Yes, being introduced by a dwarf wearing what appears to be an entire fox around his neck. And speaking with a very broad Scottish accent.
Let me cut right to the chase, Commander, for I'm not a man who takes pride in his words, but in his pragmatism, rather. The entire realm is under siege, and the free peoples left need a strong leader. One who inspires.
So certainly not you, then.
You see...
Could we stop zooming in closer?
I don't... Commander.
I don't want to be any closer to this man's corpulent chin.
Political concerns will take precedence over military ones, no matter how trivial they may sometimes seem in these dark times. As much as possible, where your rule has been established, everyday life must continue like it would in times of peace, and everyday life concerns itself with everyday worries. The people will look to you for guidance in these matters. We, as their representatives, have witnessed your triumphs with mounting awe, and have agreed you are to be the one, the hero, who shall both restore the kingdom and recommence the workings of government. I therefore declare you emperor. Long live the emperor!
Yes, the emperor of, like, what, two provinces?
Long live the Emperor!
Okay, grand. Okay, so now we get to meet our small armada of various counselors, including the undead. The fact that they're there... The fact that they're there does amuse me greatly. The fact that the undead actually do have a political presence is very strange. You don't see that much in fantasy settings where the undead are actually reasonable and capable of being involved in the civilization. Right, so... couple of the people I can basically boil down to some very broad parodies. The dwarf, Sir Falstaff. Fuck me, he's actually called Falstaff. Jesus. I forgot his name. Sir Falstaff Silvervane is business tycoons. Right-wing conservative business interests. Oberon. Fuck me, he's called Oberon. Prospera. Trinket. Yorick Falstaff. Oberon. Okay, for those of you watching this at home, if you know more about Shakespeare than I do, could you tell me if Prospera and if these two's names, the imp and the lizard woman's names, are also Shakespeare references? Because it's only just struck me that we got fucking Yorick, Oberon, and Falstaff. So, yeah, anyway. Oberon is, as you might guess with an elf, left-wing hyper-environmentalism. The undead, weirdly, right-wing Catholicism. Like, really conservative and repressed religious concerns. I'm not entirely certain how to boil down these last two. Trinculo, however the hell his name's pronounced, I've forgotten, seems to be something of a wild card. Generally, he will be in support of science, but other than that, he tends to jump back and forth. Prospera, no idea, couldn't tell you. Right, in fact, let's start talking with the imp.
By Grumio's gadgets, it's a pleasure indeed to shake hands with you, Commander. Your technician is my nephew, don't you know? And I am Trinculo Shortfuse, son of Trunculo Even Shorter Fuse. Praised be the dragon!
That is, that's weird that Grumio is your nephew, because, you look a hell of a lot younger than Grumio. What will the imps bring to the table?
Ha! You want gizmos? You want imps. You want the unthinkable? You want imps. You want great, big, loud, bright fire explosions? Lords above, it's imps you want. We live for all that is new and shiny.
As I can tell with you, by your hat, which must weigh a fucking ton.
The old, we blow it up. The new, we study it for a while before we blow it up. Why? Because there's always something even newer waiting around the corner. Science, Great Dragon, never sits still. Try, investigate, experiment. And with a bit of luck, boom! Ha ha ha! A bigger bang than ever. On a more serious note though, Commander, science is indeed our passion, and we hope that under your rule, we will be free to explore its limits. Damn the gods, for there are none, and damn petty morality, for it is a break on progress. Back us, and we'll craft you miracles.
I like this guy. I like this guy and his political and religious views. He's cool. Okay, Prospera.
By the powers vested in me by the great lizard lords, I, Prospera, endorse your newfound emperorship. Sorely, we are in need of a dragon commander.
Yeah. I've never fully been certain as to exactly what she's supposed to be kind of a broad parody of. She's a hell of a lot more reasonable than friggin' Edmund. She's not a horrifying racist. What? Tell me about the lizards.
We are not a people that make great demands, Commander. We simply hold many a thing dear without succumbing to the excess of it.
I think they're supposed to be kind of political neutrals, generally. I think that's what the lizards are.
The dwarves revere their gold to such an extent it becomes a fetish. Elves abide so strictly by nature they become her slaves. We like gold, for it is an economical must. We like nature, for she sustains us. Yet none of the two we idolize. Reason and liberty, those are our bywords. Territories we defend valiantly. Territories, alas, easily encroached upon, for emperors tend to curtail them. Our ideal is therefore not a monarchy, but a republic. Think on that, Commander, as you pursue the throne.
Yeah, I'm not gonna have any republics, because if there's a republic, I'm not emperor, and I... not a fan of that. Right, Falstaff?
Isn't this a world gone topsy-turvy? I've declared you emperor, and you don't even know my name. Sir Falstaff Silvervane, Commander. Born and bred neath the Emerald Mountains. There. Now that we've been acquainted, I do declare it's time for a beer.
Yeah, he's a dwarf. I'm not sure if any of you picked up on that, but Falstaff Silvervane is a dwarf. Yep.
A prouder folk you'll ne'er meet, Commander.
Already have, Edmund.
A more robust one. Best allies an aspiring king can have. For our love of gold and all things precious is legendary. And gold is what an emperor needs, if it be conquest that takes his fancy. So listen when I give advice, for your economy will prosper by it.
Yeah, I think already, even though I already told you what this guy is basically supposed to serve as, you can already see it. Like, right off the bat, everyone describes the dwarves as being greedy fuckwits, and he's just immediately admitted the dwarves are greedy fuckwits, so...
Liquid gold, of course, is another of our pride and joys. For ale a sparkle, we'd go to war. But our families, above all, Commander, are holy. Those manifold kernels that band together and like the rings that form a chain mail, shape a society that is stout and steadfast.
So yeah, right-wing, business-focused conservatism.
Yes, dwarven families grow as plenty as the grain on a thousand wheat fields. And just like grain, it is from them that we derive the bread that nourishes civilization and the beer that quenches its thirst.
So yeah, as you may be able to imagine, probably not going to agree with Falstaff very often. Not going to be on his side much. Neither am I going to be on the side of Oberon that much. Here we go.
To meet you, Commander. I am Oberon, envoy of the elves, ambassador of the beasts, spokesman of plants.
And pretentious arsehole. Got him.
New emperor will treat majestic Rivalon with the reverence she deserves, even in these times of frightful war.
Well, I'm setting fire to shit and bombing people, so we're probably going to have some problems. What is it that makes elves tick? Because I believe you are made of clockwork. Feel free to tell me otherwise.
If elves were the only race to have become what they misnomer civilized, this globe and all upon it would exist in a paradise of such perfection, the gods need not create for us a heaven. Such, alas, is the fiction, not the reality.
Good God, you just want to punch him, don't you?
Others less scrupulous in the handling of natural beauty have risen to prominence. They hack and mine, blast, drain, and usurp. As much as we condemn and attempt to stop their misguided endeavors. We are the Green Mothers, unwavering paladins. And it is our fondest desire you, Commander, will join our ranks.
Not bloody likely.
Defend nature, and defend the little man, for they will in turn defend you. A happy people, one with the wilds, will fight for its country with redoubled zeal. To that effect, I hope we'll have your backing.
Yeah, probably not. You know, this is actually the problem I have, is that, like, generally, as you can probably guess, that there are some counselors that almost always actively oppose each other. Yorick and Trinquilo, Oberon and Falstaff. Like, you know, Oberon and Falstaff always oppose each other. Yorick and Trinquilo always oppose each other. When it comes to Yorick and the Imp, I typically would go with the Imp, because he's more sensible and he's a religious nutcase. But I don't fucking agree with Falstaff or Oberon 90% of the time. So I'm just like, I don't know. Right, let's talk to my favorite counselor, Yorick.
May the Seven be praised now that we have found our champion and our emperor. May the fire of the dragon obliterate every heretic in its way. May the light of the gods illuminate your soul.
You know, it hadn't occurred to me that the gods, that it's the faith of the Seven. We've got the Imp and a guy who preaches the faith of the Seven. I'm not going to be able to avoid making Game of Thrones jokes here. You hold the gods in high regards, it seems. Weird, given the fact that you're an unholy abomination, but there you go.
The highest. We are the chosen of the Seven, Commander. We are those that have known death, have walked its black shores, but then have been restored to life.
He has a weirdly bendy skull.
You think you are alive now, Commander, but you are not. You are but in the phase of flesh. Yet if you are devout and sweat in service of the Seven, you too, after the Dark Mother has lulled you to sleep, may be plucked from the dales of shadow and given the perpetuity of the bone.
It's weird religious significance they've given to undeath. It's not something you see very often in fantasy.
Do well by the gods, Commander, and you'll do well by us, as well as all in the realm. We have many proposals to that effect, which I will bring before you in due time. So say I, Yorick, humble servant of the Seven.
So, yeah, religious moralizing. That's what he does. Hello, Grumio, son of Gromio, son of fucking whatever. Okay, let's go. Let's go talk to Maxos. Let's actually get something for Maxos, shall we? Let's take Saw, just so he can move quicker. Right, so the last episode was about 40 minutes long. We're just about to hit 25 minutes, so I think I'm going to cut this and get back to some more battling in the next video. But that's going to have to be all for me for now. I've been your humble narrator, Sardis Thinker, and as always, keep calm and carry on. Good day. Well, I hope you enjoyed watching that video as much as I enjoyed making it. Well, I say that. I could have been having a really shitty day when I recorded that. You can't tell, and I certainly can't. Pre-recorded message and all that. Anyway, just here to say that I have a Twitter account that you can follow if you want occasional updates of random thoughts from me, and that if you're feeling generous, feel free to donate to my Patreon campaign. Every penny donated there makes life easier for me generally and slowly goes towards me getting a better gaming PC. Well, that's that. It's over. Leave. Now. Now!
Do not seek the sideways thinker. Do not seek the pardoner.